Good morning. This is Radio Good News. The goal of this program is to draw all people to the love of Jesus Christ. I want everyone to know and experience the fruit of the Holy Spirit: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Those are key to a Holy Spirit-filled and successful Christian life. I will focus on God's love because God's love is wonderful. I'm John Thornton. I will be reading from the Bible, the New Revised Standard Version, and let's begin today with some readings from Psalm 66. Make a joyful noise to God, all the earth. Sing the glory of His name. Give to Him glorious praise. Say to God, how awesome are your deeds. Because of your great power, your enemies cringe before you. All the earth worships you. They sing praises to you, sing praises to your name. Come and see what God has done. He is awesome in His deeds among mortals. Bless our God, O peoples. Let the sound of His praise be heard, who has kept us among the living and has not let our feet slip. For you, O God, have tested us. You have tried us as silver is tried. You brought us into the net. You laid burdens on our backs. You let people ride over our heads. We went through fire and through water. Yet you have brought us out to a spacious place. Come and hear, all you who fear God, and I will tell what He has done for me. I cried aloud to Him, and He was extolled with my tongue. If I had cherished iniquity in my heart, the Lord would not have listened. But truly God has listened. He has given heed to the words of my prayer. Blessed be God, because He has not rejected my prayer or removed His steadfast love from me. Those are God's words from Psalm 66, and our musical guest today is Michelle Tumes.
I wish.
That was Michelle Tumes. We'll hear from her again at the end of the program. Stay tuned for that. Turn with me, if you can, to Mark's Gospel, chapter 9. And Jesus said to them, "Truly I tell you, there are some standing here who will not taste death until they see that the kingdom of God has come with power." 6 days later, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John and led them up a high mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his clothes became dazzling white, such as no one on earth could bleach them. And there appeared to them Elijah with Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us make 3 dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what to say, for they were terrified. Then a cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud there came a voice, "This is my son, the beloved. Listen to him." Suddenly, when they looked around, they saw no one with them anymore, but only Jesus. As they were coming down the mountain, he ordered them to tell no one about what they had seen until after the Son of Man had risen from the dead. So they kept the matter to themselves, questioning what this rising from the dead could mean. Then they asked him, "Why do the scribes say that Elijah must come first?" Jesus said to them, "Elijah is indeed coming first to restore all things. How then is it written about the Son of Man that he is to go through many sufferings and to be treated with contempt? But I tell you that Elijah has come." And they did to him whatever they pleased, as it is written about him. When they came to the disciples, they saw a great crowd around them and some scribes arguing with them. When the whole crowd saw Jesus, they were immediately overcome with awe, and they ran forward to greet him. He asked them, "What are you arguing about with them?" Someone from the crowd answered him, "Teacher, I brought you my son. He has a spirit that makes him unable to speak, and whenever it seizes him, it dashes him down, and he foams and grinds his teeth and becomes rigid. I asked your disciples to cast it out, but they could not do so." Jesus answered them, "You faithless generation, how much longer must I be among you? How much longer must I put up with you? Bring him to me." And they brought the boy to him. When the spirit saw him, immediately it convulsed the boy, and he fell on the ground and rolled about foaming at the mouth. Jesus asked the father, "How long has this been happening to him?" And he said, "From childhood. It has often cast him into the fire and into the water to destroy him, but if you are able to do anything, have pity on us and help us." Jesus said to him, "If you are able, all things can be done for the one who believes." Immediately the father of the child cried out, "I believe, help my unbelief." When Jesus saw that the crowd came running together, he rebuked the unclean spirit, saying to it, "You spirit that keeps this boy from speaking and hearing, I command you, come out of him and never enter him again." After crying out and convulsing him terribly, it came out, and the boy was like a corpse, so that most of them said, "He is dead." But Jesus took him by the hand and lifted him up, and he was able to stand. When he had entered the house, his disciples asked Jesus privately, "Why could we not cast it out?" He said to them, "This kind can only come out through prayer." They went on from there and passed through Galilee. He did not want anyone to know it, for he was teaching his disciples, saying to them, "The Son of Man is to be betrayed into human hands, and they will kill him, and 3 days after being killed he will rise again." But they did not understand what he was saying and were afraid to ask him. Then they came to Capernaum, and when he was in the house, he asked them, "What were you arguing about on the way?" But they were silent, for on the way they had argued with one another, who was the greatest? Jesus sat down, called the 12, and said to them, "Whoever wants to be first must be last and servant of all." Then Jesus took a little child and put him among them, and taking him in his arms, he said to them, "Whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes not me, but the one who sent me." John said to him, "A teacher, we saw someone casting out demons in your name, and we tried to stop him because he was not following us." But Jesus said, "Do not stop him, for no one who does a deed of power in my name will be able soon afterward to speak evil of me. Whoever is not against us is for us. For truly I tell you, whoever gives you a cup of water to drink because you bear the name of Christ will by no means lose the reward. If any of you puts a stumbling block before one of these little ones who believe in me, it would be better for you if a great millstone were hung around your neck and you were thrown into the sea. If your hand causes you to stumble, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life maimed than to have two hands and to go to hell, to the unquenchable fire. And if your foot causes you to stumble, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life lame than to have two feet and be thrown into hell. And if your eye causes you to stumble, tear it out. It is better for you to enter the kingdom of God with one eye than to have two eyes and be thrown into hell, where their worm never dies and the fire is never quenched. For everyone will be salted with fire. Salt is good, but if salt has lost its saltiness, how can you season it? Have salt in yourselves and be at peace with one another." Those are God's words from Mark chapter 9. An interesting story is about President Franklin D. Roosevelt, who was tired of phoniness. So one evening, he decided to test the visitors. Were they actually listening? So during that reception, he greeted the visitors, shook each of their hands, and smiled his big and friendly presidential smile. Then as each person passed by, President Roosevelt said, "I murdered my grandmother this morning." People would automatically respond with comments like, "Oh, how wonderful," or, "Oh, just keep up your good work." Nobody listened to what he actually said. He said, "I murdered my grandmother this morning." Of all the guests, no one listened at all, except for one foreign diplomat. He responded, "Oh, I'm sure she must have had it coming to her." As Christians, do we ever truly listen to God? I wonder. As we continue to study Mark's gospel, I want you to consider the question, do I truly listen to God? Remember, God inspired Mark to pen these words. Mark listened. Mark was used by God to record a witness document. Mark wrote about what he knew to be true. The Gospel of Mark was most likely written in Rome, probably about the year 50 AD. And this gospel was written for us, to help us in our lives. The Apostle Paul wrote in 2 Timothy 3:16 through 17, "All scripture is inspired by God and is useful for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, so that everyone who belongs to God may be proficient, equipped for every good work." And in Romans 15:4 we read, "For whatever was written in former days was written for our instruction, so that by steadfastness and by the encouragement of the scriptures we might have hope." Sometimes we know exactly who wrote the passages of the Bible, as in Paul's letters, but other times the author is unknown, like in the book of Hebrews. In our Gospel of Mark, nowhere do we find Mark telling us that he wrote the text, but we have great historical testimony that Mark was the author. So today, we read about one awesome and wondrous event, the Transfiguration. Perhaps when you were back in Sunday school, you colored a picture of Jesus standing with Moses and Elijah. Was that the one and only time you used the white crayon? Jesus took with him Peter, James, and John and led them up a high mountain, and he was transfigured before them. Just what exactly does that mean, transfigured? Well, it means that Jesus was altered in appearance, or more accurately, his true divine nature was revealed. Here was a glimpse of Jesus in his glory. In Philippians chapter 2, we read, "Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself." Now, let's stop right there. Jesus, before his birth to the Virgin Mary, existed and was God. But in order to be human as we are, Jesus emptied himself. He emptied out the glory, majesty, and omnipotence of his divine nature so he could become like us. That is why Jesus could get tired and need food and sleep, and he could even bleed and die. It is because Jesus emptied himself. Now, continuing in Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 8, Jesus emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness and being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. So the transfiguration was a sort of reversal of that emptying. Here Jesus was in his glory. It was amazing. His clothes were dazzling white. He was perfect, pure, and honorable. It was a glimpse into heaven. And with Jesus were Moses and Elijah. And this shows that the afterlife is real, for these great Old Testament heroes had lived hundreds and hundreds of years before, but were now in glory with God. This whole experience was far more stupendous than we can imagine. It overwhelmed and terrified Peter, James, and John. Then a cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud there came a voice. "This is my Son, the Beloved. Listen to him." And here is a message for us. Listen to Jesus. Do we? Do we listen to Jesus? Well, their travels continued. And along the way, the disciples were discussing Elijah. Jesus said, "Elijah is indeed coming first to restore all things. How then is it written about the Son of Man that he is to go through many sufferings and be treated with contempt? But I tell you that Elijah has come." And they did to him whatever they pleased, as it is written about him. Well, this is clarified by Matthew in Matthew 11:11 through 14, when Jesus says, "Truly I tell you, among those born of women, no one has arisen greater than John the Baptist, yet the least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. From the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven has suffered violence, and the violent take it by force. For all the prophets in the law prophesied until John came. And if you are willing to accept it, John the Baptist is Elijah who is to come." Do you remember Elijah? In 1 Kings chapter 19, we read how Elijah came to a cave and spent the night there. And the Lord came to him saying, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" And Elijah spoke with God. Then Elijah was told, "Go out and stand on the mountain before the Lord, for the Lord is about to pass by." And there was a great wind so strong that it was splitting the mountains and breaking the rocks in pieces. But the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake. But the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire. But the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, a sound of sheer silence. When Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in his mantle and went out and stood at the entrance to that cave. And there came a voice that said, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" Elijah learned that God is not always in the big and flashy things, but sometimes is in the stillness of the wee small voice. Do we listen to God? Well, then they encountered an argument, some scribes arguing with the disciples. Jesus asked them, "What are you arguing about?" Well, someone from the crowd said, "Oh, teacher, I brought you my son, and he has a spirit that makes him unable to speak. And whenever it seizes him, it dashes him down, and he foams and grinds his teeth and becomes rigid. I asked your disciples to cast it out, but they could not do so." A distraught father had brought his child to the disciples to be set free from demonic possession. Remember, demons are real. They're evil, wicked, and horrible. They seek to destroy life and to kill. They're out there in the shadows to trip us up and hurt us, like Satan, the father of lies. The disciples had failed when they tried to perform that exorcism. The demon was still tormenting the child. Jesus told the crowd, "You faithless generation, how much longer must I be among you? How much longer must I put up with you? Bring the afflicted boy to me." When the evil spirit saw Jesus, immediately it convulsed the boy. It attacked the boy. The boy fell on the ground and rolled about foaming at the mouth. Jesus asked the father, "How long has this been happening to him?" And the father said, "Oh, from childhood. It has often cast him into the fire or into the water to destroy him. But if you are able to do anything, have pity on us and help us. Did you hear that statement? The father says, if you are able to help. The father doubts. After all, the disciples were miserable failures when they tried to cure the boy and just argued with the Pharisees. So should the father not doubt the leader of what he saw as failures? Jesus said to him, if you are able, all things can be done for the one who believes. Jesus sees into that man's heart and has compassion on him. Jesus reflects back those exact words, if you are able, and then assures the man that if he believes, he will be blessed. And the man listens. He hears the words and he listens. He searches his heart and he finds faith and he declares out, I believe, help my unbelief. What a great confession of faith. Yes, I believe, but help me. That is a lesson for each of us today, isn't it? If we are honest, I'm sure there are many things that each of us wonder about. I certainly do not understand everything. I have my own doubts. And this man states, I believe, help my unbelief. He is basically saying, I trust you, Jesus, but I do not understand. Please help me. And that profession and cry for help was prompted because he listened to Jesus. Jesus loves children. He cares deeply about each and every child. So in that great love, he reached down and said, you spirit that keeps this boy from speaking and hearing, I command you, come out of him and never enter him again. After crying out and attacking the boy terribly, the demon came out. Do you see? It was a miracle. The demon was cast out. The demon clearly hears Jesus and cries out when it is driven away. For even the demons hear and listen to Jesus Christ, our Master and Messiah. The demons do not like it, but they must submit to Jesus, for he is victor over all. But at first, the boy was like a corpse. Perhaps he truly was dead. Most of the crowd said, he is dead. But Jesus took the boy by the hand and lifted him up. Not only did Jesus drive out the demon, the spiritual enemy, but he also healed the boy's physical state, possibly even raising him from the dead, all because that father listened to Jesus. Do you listen to Jesus? They journey onward, and the disciples ask, well, why couldn't we cast it out? Jesus says that it sometimes takes prayer and fasting. Prayer and fasting are humble signs of personal piety, not grand signs of dominance. For the main issue with the disciples seems to be that they wanted that raw power. They argued about who was the greatest among them, but they did not understand. So Jesus gave them and us a living illustration, an example about listening. Jesus sat down, called the 12, and said to them, whoever wants to be the first must be last of all and servant of all. Then Jesus took another little child and put him among them, and taking him in his arms, he said to them, whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes not me, but the one who sent me. The disciples did not understand. John said, oh, hey, we saw this other guy who was successful in casting out demons, but we ordered him to stop since he was not one of us. Jesus responded, oh, do not stop him. Whoever is not against us is for us. The disciples had not been listening. Again, they'd missed the point. But that little child in Jesus' arms, he didn't miss the point. Have you ever wondered what happened to that little child who Jesus picked up and used as his living illustration? Well, tradition tells us that that little child listened intently. His name was Ignatius, and he was about 5 years old when Jesus carried him about in that speech. Ignatius grew up and was known as the one born by God, in reference back to his being picked up by Jesus. He became the bishop of Antioch, a great church leader. He served Jesus Christ well for another 72 years. Ignatius, the one born by God, was murdered for his faith in the year 107 AD. But he had listened to God. Will you? Will you listen? Consider as I read Jesus' words. Truly I tell you, whoever gives a cup of water to drink because you bear the name of Christ will by no means lose the reward. If any of you puts a stumbling block before one of these little ones who believe in me, it would be better for you if you had a great millstone hung around your neck and were thrown into the sea. If your hand causes you to stumble, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life maimed than to have two hands and go to hell, to the unquenchable fire. And if your foot causes you to stumble, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life lame than to have 2 feet and be thrown into hell. And if your eye causes you to stumble, tear it out. It is better for you to enter the kingdom of God with one eye than to have 2 eyes and be thrown into hell, where their worm never dies and the fire is never quenched. For everyone will be salted with fire. Salt is good, but if salt has lost its saltiness, how can you season it? Have salt in yourselves and be at peace with one another. So again, my friends, I ask, will you listen to Jesus? I'm John Thornton. Thank you for listening to Radio Good News. I encourage you to seek out a church family where you can worship, be encouraged, and listen to Jesus. For this area offers many fine Bible-believing and teaching churches of various denominations. You can write to me, and I enjoy your cards and letters. Write to me at Radio Good News, P.O. Box 1722, Sioux Falls, South Dakota, 57101. May you richly know the blessings of the God who was, the God who is, and the God who is to come again. And always remember, the Bible tells us that love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. Love does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. Love does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, and endures all things. Love never ends. So love Jesus Christ our Lord with all your heart, strength, soul, and mind, and love your neighbors as yourselves, and we're even commanded to love our enemies. We'll finish today with another beautiful song from Michelle Tumes.
You when you smile.